may be the greatest catch I've ever seen in my life.
Okay. I know. Yes. I understand. People are not going to like this video. People are going to be going to the comment section, just like the last video where I called Terry McLaurin a bad draft pick, and they are going to just absolutely destroy me. And that is fine. I encourage you to go down there and use that comment section whenever you think I am wrong. But what we need to do is we need to have a civil discussion here, because y'all know that one of the reasons I think this YouTube channel is so much better than really any other one you're going to find is we are all in this together. We are all working together here. And that's why it's so important that you leave your opinion below. But the opinions that just say, Mason, you're an idiot, why did you say this? And they don't come through with anything to back that up. I mean, those opinions, I just want to say, are kind of meaningless. But you'll see that almost every single video that I say something that a lot of people don't like, if someone comes out and they leave me a 2 to 3 paragraph long explanation on why they believe I am wrong with that take, I mean, I will pin it to the very top. I'll drop the little heart on it. That way other people can get the other side of the discussion. So please, if you think I am wrong, what you need to do here is watch this entire video. Don't just get triggered, leave the video, and then call me an idiot. No, if you want to have a discussion where we can talk about why Terry McLaurin is one of the worst drafted wide receivers in fantasy drafts at the moment, watch this video, hear my points, and then you can go down to the comment section and tell me what points you thought were wrong. But please, guys, go down there, drop a like on the video, even though I know people are not going to enjoy this one because Terry McLaurin is everyone's favorite wide receiver. And subscribe to the channel if you have not already. We are going to be at 100,000 subscribers by the end of this football season. I promise you that. And literally, it's a guarantee. I mean, we are going to get that new studio. We are going to be rocking and rolling. But let's bring up Terry McLaurin here, and let's talk about why he is such a bad draft pick this season. So Terry McLaurin right now, hear me out on this, is going as the wide receiver 9, 10, or 11 in your redraft leagues. Now, this obviously is not going to be the same in every draft. That's why we're giving you a small range here. If you look at the ADP, he is essentially tied with Keenan Allen and Michael Thomas. Now, he is tied with those players in a significant tier down where you never see any of these guys going over Terry McLaurin, Keenan Allen, or Michael Thomas is CeeDee Lamb, Robert Woods, and Allen Robinson. Now, I am looking at Terry McLaurin and we go, okay, let's try to evaluate this wide receiver on a whole. Let's see if he has any traits that belong to be with this group of guys, because I have him behind every single wide receiver we just mentioned. So we are going to be releasing our 2021 fantasy football draft guide in July. And over there, you can find that Terry McLaurin is down there. And I actually have him ranked instead of tier 3. I have him down there in tier 4. I have him not only, of course, behind Keenan Allen, Michael Thomas. I mean, I think anybody with a brain should have that ranking as well. But we also have him behind Allen Robinson. I think that's a very easy call as well. Robert Woods, and CeeDee Lamb. Now, let me dive into why I think that we are actually going to be significantly lower than consensus on Terry McLaurin this year. And so first thing I want to address with Terry McLaurin is I understand he is going into year 3. This is when you expect those wide receivers to just completely cement themselves as elite options, because a lot of the times the wide receivers that are going to be those top players in the NFL, someone like from the same draft class, a DK Metcalf or an AJ Brown, they're coming out after their true junior season in college. They're getting to the NFL at 20 years old. And then by the time they get to the third year, well, finally, they are 23, about to be 24 years old, and they are going into their prime. They are going to be able to take that next leap. Well, Terry McLaurin, unlike any wide receiver that you see jump up into this elite tier, actually came into the NFL at 23 years old. Now, of course, this isn't the entire thesis behind the avoiding play on Terry McLaurin, but it's very important because Terry McLaurin's going to be 26 this season. I think it's very hard to expect a massive jump up in his play from age 25 to 26, given, I mean, he has had so much time to develop already that I think expecting him to get significantly better, as you would expect a traditional wide receiver going into year 3 that's about to be 23, 24 years old, I think it's a little bit harder to do with Terry McLaurin. So what we have to do is we have to view him not necessarily as a prospect the past 2 years, because he was a prospect, at least was a prospect that was 23 years old. So I think he was a little bit closer to a finished product than a lot of other wide receivers in this range. So we go through and we look at him the past 2 years, and I will be the first one to acknowledge. I mean, Terry McLaurin had, if not the worst quarterback play in the NFL, one of the worst quarterback plays in the NFL. I mean, he had Dwayne Haskins, Alex Smith, Case Keenum. I mean, just nothing over the past 2 years. And in 2019, Terry McLaurin had a very impressive season. I mean, he came out and a lot of people were viewing him as maybe the best wide receiver value in the NFL draft, which is a completely fair case to make. I mean, he was someone drafted in round three in 2019. He comes out and he's actually a wide receiver three in fantasy, finishes as the wide receiver 30 in points per game with 13.5 points per game. And he does this with both volume and efficiency. I mean, he averages 6.5 targets, 65 yards a game, and he has half a touchdown a game. So you love those marks for a rookie across the board. I mean, that's fantastic for Terry McLaurin, especially when he had nobody at quarterback. I mean, this is notable. Of course, you have to tip your cap to Terry McLaurin. And there's a reason why I'm still ranking him as a wide receiver too in fantasy. It's not like I don't like the guy at all. He's a great wide receiver. I just can't get behind him being an elite option. And a big thing with this is his sophomore year in 2020. I think so many people are overrating what actually happened. Now, yes, he had some of the worst quarterback play in the NFL. We have already admitted that. And he comes out and he averages 15 points per game. He is the wide receiver 20 in points per game, 74 receiving yards. Now, the volume is there, and you love to see the volume. Nobody can deny that. Almost 9 targets a game, and that is fantastic for Terry McLaurin. But I really don't want people to be viewing Terry McLaurin as if he was a wide receiver one last season. And the best way I can come about just explaining this is let's talk about the narrative between all the wide receivers that finished in the range wide receiver 20 to wide receiver 28. Okay, so Terry McLaurin finishes as the wide receiver 20, right? Well, the wide receiver 23, who was he? Oh, he was one of the biggest busts in fantasy football last year. One of the biggest busts in fantasy football over the past 5 seasons. Juju Smith-Schuster. And I know a lot of people are going to be going, well, Mason, it was Terry McLaurin's only second season in the NFL. Juju has been here since 2017. Why are you comparing these two guys? It's because they finished neck and neck in fantasy finishes. And as we already mentioned, Terry McLaurin stayed all 5 years in college. Terry McLaurin is actually a year older than Juju Smith-Schuster. So you're looking at Juju as a 24-year-old finishing as the wide receiver 23. Terry McLaurin as someone that, I mean, already 25, had no competition for targets at all in his offense. And now, yes, he had some of the worst quarterback play in the NFL. But, I mean, what are you going to be saying here about Juju Smith-Schuster? Are you going to be arguing that Ben Roethlisberger is a top 15 quarterback? And now this is not me trying to pump up Juju Smith-Schuster. I mean, I am admitting we got that wrong last year. Well, yes, Juju was technically a wide receiver too. He did not live up anything close to the expectations that I had for him. But I'm more so using this reference in trying to give us a frame of mind to see where Terry McLaurin actually was in fantasy last year, because I think the numbers are just completely different than what the narrative had. And if you look at some other wide receivers in this range, I mean, wide receiver 24, Antonio Brown. Wide receiver 25, Jameson Crowder. 26, Marvin Jones. 27, his new teammate in Curtis Samuel. And now, what's different between someone like Terry McLaurin and all these other wide receivers is, while, yes, Terry McLaurin suffered from some of the worst quarterback play in the NFL, we are going to continue to say that because I want people to understand we are being fair with our assessment of Terry McLaurin here. I have nothing against McLaurin. And actually, in that 2019 NFL draft class, he was going extremely late in dynasty formats. And y'all know I love dynasty fantasy football. And when he was drafted in the 3rd round by Washington on a depth chart that did not have much talent, and he was falling to the late 3rd, early 4th of some dynasty rookie drafts, I thought that as a rookie, he was one of the best values in all of fantasy football. And he was actually one of my highest owned players in those 2019 rookie drafts. And of course, we sold him after that rookie year. I did not expect him to make that elite jump, and his value has continued to climb. So it was bad on me for deciding to sell him. I just want to make sure everybody understands I don't have some massive bias against Terry McLaurin here. I'm just looking at the numbers. And what's very important in understanding this production that he's had over the past 2 years is, while yes, it's been volume filled, that's what we want to see. But I mean, look at the competition for targets on this offense. in 2019, his rookie season, he comes out and the other players that were able to get 40 targets on this offense include, okay, so keep in mind, this is how many players got over 40 targets for Washington in 2019. You had Jeremy Sprinkle, Paul Richardson, Kelvin Harmon, Trey Quinn, Steven Sims, and Chris Thompson. Those were the only wide receivers, running backs, tight ends that were able to get over 40 targets on this offense besides Terry McLaurin. Now, I understand what that means is that means, hell, defenses can literally just scheme about Terry McLaurin. They do not have to worry about anyone else. And that's a very fair argument to make. That was one of the best arguments that we got in the comment section of last video where we discussed McLaurin. But the problem with that is understanding what is more predictive season to season and what is going to matter with target competition coming in. So while yes, it is true in the case of Terry McLaurin that other wide receivers coming in should be able to help him get just a little bit more free against opposing defenses. They're not going to be able to scheme everything against McLaurin. So his efficiency should go up, but the volume will go down. And what we chase is volume, volume, volume. So I don't even think it's that good of a thing for Terry McLaurin. And now in 2020, it was something very similar. I mean, here you have J.D. McKissic, Logan Thomas, Cam Sims, Antonio Gibson, Steven Sims, and Isaiah Wright as the only players that can get 30 targets on this offense. So Terry McLaurin literally battling with nobody for targets over the past 2 years. And now all of a sudden, you have Curtis Samuel coming in with a very nice contract we'll get to later. You have Dyami Brown being drafted in the third round. You have Kelvin Harmon, someone who is at the top of this team in targets a few years ago. Now he is going to be healthy for 2021 again. And also, you have Logan Thomas going into year two on this offense. So you have a lot of different players kind of coming into the situation in Washington. So I think if you're looking at Terry McLaurin, someone who finished right next to Juju Smith-Schuster last year, someone that I think you can't really project him to get that much better in terms of his talent profile. And he's going ahead of Keenan Allen, Michael Thomas, CeeDee Lamb, Robert Woods, Allen Robinson in fantasy drafts right now. I think that is crazy. Now, there is great value to be had on this roster because Ryan Fitzpatrick coming in is going to produce fantasy points. We know Fitzpatrick may not necessarily be a great NFL quarterback himself, but when he starts, he is going to be fantastic for the players in this offense in generating air yards, generating fantasy points. But Terry McLaurin is not who we're going to go with. Our next wide receiver, I actually think, is a much better value in Curtis Samuel. So you pull up Curtis Samuel right now, okay? So it's a night and day difference. We already discussed the fact that, I mean, with Curtis Samuel, he was about 7 spots behind Terry McLaurin in less than 1 point a game, a difference last year in fantasy standings. Now, while Terry McLaurin is being drafted as a top 10 wide receiver, Curtis Samuel is being drafted as a wide receiver 4. He is wide receiver 40 in ADP. And with Curtis Samuel, if you think Terry McLaurin's going to be able to continue to get better going into his age 26 season, Curtis Samuel right now is 24. He's going into his age 25 season. So if you're going to be projecting one wide receiver to continue to get better, I mean, that player would probably be Curtis Samuel. Being drafted behind Will Fuller, Hollywood Brown, and Tyler Boyd, I mean, I think this is a fantastic value because we already discussed, I mean, this is a wide receiver that came out and he was like the wide receiver 27, 28 in points per game last year. And what's really funny is he actually left a game early last year due to injury where he played less than 50% of the snaps. And if you remove that game, you actually have Curtis Samuel as the wide receiver 25, only 5 spots behind Terry McLaurin, played in an offense with DJ Moore. I mean, Teddy Bridgewater, very, very bad last year. It's going to be hard to use that as an argument against Curtis Samuel. And also, he had Robbie Anderson there as well. I mean, he had significant target competition. And what's really funny is we can go back to these two wide receivers. We can go back to them playing on the same team and see what happened here. Okay, so they both played at Ohio State. Everybody knows that. But what's great is they were at Ohio State at the same time. They were both on the roster in 2016, and they both were actually able to get into the game. Now, I will say it's a little bit unfair to compare these two wide receivers so long ago because it was 5 years ago. So, of course, this is nothing. I mean, this is very, very little other than to show you that Curtis Samuel is a very talented wide receiver in his own right. When you're viewing both of these players in the same situation, what happened? And what happened back then with Curtis Samuel only being 20 years old versus Terry McLaurin being 21 is Curtis Samuel came out and he had 865 receiving yards this season. Now, he also had 771 rushing yards for over 1,600 total yards this year. Now, Terry McLaurin had a little over 100. So please don't just think I am saying that Curtis Samuel is a better wide receiver than Terry McLaurin. I'm just simply trying to say that these wide receivers are a little closer than what most people want to believe. I mean, we see this in fantasy points scored last year. We see this in their production when they were in the same situation in college. And we also see this with Washington going out of their way and deciding to give him a very nice contract. I mean, they go and they, instead of just signing him to a one-year prove-it deal like Juju Smith-Schuster, like Will Fuller both got, he actually gets $23 million guaranteed in this contract. And I mean, this is ridiculous. It's a contract value of $34 million for Curtis Samuel. This is right up there with only Kenny Golladay from this past year at the wide receiver position. So Washington is telling us that they value Curtis Samuel in the same light. So right now, when he's going into this situation where he has less competition for targets than he did last year, and last year he finished as the wide receiver 25, now he's going as the wide receiver 40. I am all in on Curtis Samuel at this price. I think it's a much better bargain than what you're getting with Terry McLaurin. I mean, I think most people are expecting McLaurin to be up here, Curtis Samuel to be way down here. And I think they're probably somewhere in the middle and a lot closer to each other than fantasy prices would have you believe. Now, another player that I actually like the value a little bit more than Terry McLaurin on this offense is going to be Logan Thomas. Okay, so with Logan Thomas, it's just funny here because, I mean, you're hearing the argument against Logan Thomas. Well, I mean, he only got targeted so heavily because there was no other competition for targets in that offense. You've heard that with Logan Thomas time and time and time again. People are saying that Curtis Samuel coming in, Dyami Brown coming in, is going to hurt Logan Thomas. And I understand that thesis. But the difference here is Logan Thomas finished last year as the wide receiver 4 in points per game. He had almost 7 targets a game, 42 total yards a game, didn't even have positive touchdown variance. I mean, only scored the ball 6 times in total 16 games. And we know someone with this size, you'd expect if the volume's there, you're probably expecting more total touchdowns. So Logan Thomas finished as the tight end 4 last year. And I mean, the argument you're hearing with a player like Terry McLaurin is, well, Mason, you don't understand. Ryan Fitzpatrick coming in is going to provide so much fantasy value here. You don't understand. Curtis Samuel coming in is going to make it where the defense can't just plan for one of these players in particular. Well, yeah, but on the flip side of that, why is Logan Thomas now being drafted as the tight end number 9? I mean, this is what I want to point out here. I just want to point out that you're seeing Curtis Samuel, Logan Thomas, dip down in fantasy value going into a situation where their starting quarterback is Ryan Fitzpatrick and going into a situation where it may be a little bit harder to get targets. Whereas you're seeing everybody ignore the red flags, be very excited about the talent because he is a talented wide receiver in Terry McLaurin, and they're projecting him to take a significant step up. They're projecting him to go from the wide receiver 20 last year to being someone that's better than Keenan Allen, better than Michael Thomas, better than Allen Robinson. That's what this video is about. That's why we are breaking this down. And the reason I kept Ryan Fitzpatrick for the very end of the video is because I know a lot of people are going to hate me saying this, but why is everybody just acting like Ryan Fitzpatrick there is just saving Terry McLaurin and going to be the best thing ever? And while I agree, when Ryan Fitzpatrick starts, I mean, he is that D-gaff quarterback that's going to be airing it out, and it's not going to be great for Washington, but it's going to be fantastic for the options in that passing game. But what we have to understand is we have to understand, how many games can we actually project for Ryan Fitzpatrick? This is a quarterback that really does not make it through the full season ever. I mean, the last time he started all 16 games was 2015. And if you look at 2016, 2017, 2018, 2019, and 2020, that 5-year stretch, I mean, he averages 8 games started a year. And in those 8 games, it's not like he is just starting and then a high-level rookie is taking over for him. The reason he's only averaging 8 games started is because this is a quarterback that his season totals have been him averaging 11.5 touchdowns a season and 10.5 interceptions. He's throwing an interception for almost every single touchdown that he throws as well. Now, to mention that he's going to be 39 years old, so you're not expecting him to get any better anytime soon. If anything, a fall off could be on the horizon. And who is to say that Ryan Fitzpatrick only gets 6 games to start here and all of a sudden it's Kyle Allen? So I would say, I mean, if we can guarantee all 16 games from Ryan Fitzpatrick, then I would probably be walking away with every single Logan Thomas and every single Curtis Samuel share that I could possibly get for these drafts. Now, the quarterback question is still a massive, massive question mark for me. So we're going to be a little bit more hesitant than we would. But, I mean, all signs point to Terry McLaurin being a very, very bad draft pick this year. But please, if you have an argument that you think goes against mine and you think it holds water, please go down to the comment section. Feel free to use that all day, every day with every single video that we have. But please give me an explanation on why I'm wrong. Don't just tell me I'm stupid and then turn off the video. But thank you, my dudes. I really hope y'all enjoyed this. I really hope this helped because I know y'all probably didn't enjoy it. Go down there, drop that like, subscribe to the channel, and I'll see y'all with the video tomorrow. Thank you so much for everyone joining the flock in Will, Wesley, Ethan, Sabres, Jonah, Austin, Andrew, Doug, Brandon, and Adam. Thank you so much, my dudes.